roving microphone. Isabel, we'll bring that to you if you have something to share.
I just have something to share. Last Sabbath, we weren't here because I was not feeling well. And I just have to say, I'm glad that we live stream, because I was able to see the Christmas program and everybody did fabulously wonderful. It was great to see everybody, even if it was, how do you call, tech style. So, and then Daryl and I went to Duluth this last Wednesday. Never travel on Christmas Day because absolutely nothing is open except a gas station with your card. So no places to eat are open or nothing. Anyway, but as we got closer to Duluth, it turned out to be very, very foggy. And as the closer we got to where we were supposed to stay, couldn't even see nothing. And that's bad when Daryl says it's very hard to see. And so it was just like really split pea fog. Even with our GPS, you know, it was just hard to find the roads to turn and whatever. And I just kept praying. Because we were there for a purpose, we were going to go see the Bentleyville lights. Anyway, and so we just kept praying, because it was very scary to not see. But anyway, it was time to go because it was getting darker, but we wanted to go before it got dark so we could actually see a little bit. But as we continued and then all of a sudden, the fog was totally gone. We could see where we're going. We could see the roads, actually, and it was just amazing. It was just like God lifted it, or he blew it away, whatever he did. It was totally gone, and so we were able to see, and we were able to find our way, and even when we came back, there was no fog. So, you know, just something minor like that, it's amazing that God intervenes on behalf of something so simple as fog.
Little things are big things sometimes, aren't they?
If you can add Chloe again to the prayer list, that the Holy Spirit keep working on her and her heart, that she start a new relationship with her family. And then we're going to be experiencing something Sarah and I have never experienced before this week, and that is we'll be having a teenager in the house. And I'm thinking that's something to look forward to, and I'm looking forward to that. But
as you should be.
Yes. Happy birthday to Lola.
Lola performed no less than 3 times last week in our Christmas program. That was one of our best Christmas programs, I think. It really, really was a nice program.
So yesterday, I got done with all my my business, got home, and I broke an aquarium decoration in my fingers, and I was lucky that I didn't slice my tendons off. I went to the bone. So I spent some time in the ER last night and just wanted to thank the good Lord for keeping my movement. So, and for having people there.
To save your life, she said this morning.
I have been in our family, and the struggle at the very beginning.
Full thing, isn't it?
Here I am again. You're very easy to love, Shannon, Pastor Roger.
Amen.
But I just have to share, last Sabbath when we were watching the program, I absolutely adore and love Ethelyn.
Oh yeah.
She is, I don't care if she's gonna be 90, she is the most incredible, wonderful woman I just think, I love her.
Amen. So do we. She's a treasure.
And so, anyway, I also, Bobby, I love the snow falling on the pictures. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Bobby. Really hits the spot. He had a better picture going earlier when it was really coming down. Boy, there must be 6 feet out there by now if that's how it was snowing outside. We're only 62 days away from March, so we're getting there. It helps me to keep, you know, and that number keeps getting smaller, so. I hear you. I'm predicting no more than 5.5 out of whatever we're going to get this weekend through Monday. I'm not a great predictor, but I keep trying. Anyone else have anything else to share? Yeah, I was really blessed by the Christmas program last week. I just read. Everybody just added a nice touch to it, and the Parkers would have been, but they were at their own Christmas program. And Staples had their Christmas program last week. Well, perfect timing, though. 3 days before Christmas Eve, so it was the perfect time to have a Christmas program, and we were all blessed by it, so we're thankful for everybody who was here that week. Okay, if there's nothing else, we'll begin our service. Unspoken requests? Okay, thank you. I typically forget to ask for those, Dave, so thank you. Thank you.
so. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us safely here this morning. We're fewer numbers today because of the snow, and we certainly want those that weren't able to make it to be safe. And Father, as we worship here this morning, we ask that your Holy Spirit would be with us, that you would remind us of your immense love. Oftentimes we see the beauty around us and we take it for granted. But each snowflake is a gift, each smile, the laughter of a child, the hug of a friend. Father, you have blessed us immensely this past year, and we want to say thank you. And as we worship today, may we do so from the bottom of our hearts, to give all that we have in answer to what you have given us, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Did our church reach out into the community, and did we experience growth? Was I faithful to the Lord in reading my Bible, returning a faithful tithe, and giving generous offerings, or do I need to do some catching up? During 2020, we are no doubt going to hear about having 2020 vision, a vision for what God can do for us individually and for us as a local church and our denomination. It's time to dream of what God can do in and through us in the new year. And 2020 is a general conference year. We would strongly encourage each one to make plans to attend at least part of the session in Indianapolis, June 25th to July 4th. There is nothing like rubbing shoulders with our brothers and sisters from around the world. It affords an awesome, up-close and personal view of the universal scope of the Adventist Church like nothing else. Today is the final opportunity this year to bless the Lord with our faithful financial stewardship for Minnesota Conference Advance. Will you? Will the ushers come forward? Let's pray. Our kind, loving, wonderful Father in heaven, we give you the honor, the praise, and the glory, and the appreciation today that you so deserve. We thank you for all that we've been given, and we have been given so much, Father. And we take so much of that for granted. In fact, we probably take it all for granted, Lord, and we ask your forgiveness for that. But now it is our turn to give back, and I pray that we would give liberally to Minnesota Conference. And I thank you for this opportunity to give. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Pastor now has the children's story. Children pick up baskets in the back for an offering that goes to KOPJ Radio and to Kyle and Cindy's missionary work in Thailand and their entire team.
Jonathan's not here, but I had no idea how I was going to incorporate snowmobiles into my story this morning. My story is about a horse. That is my pony, and his name was Dobbin. That's a very old-time horse name. There's a song about it. Daryl, do you know the song?
No.
Can you sing the song?
No.
There's a very song that mentions a horse named Dobbin. He was named Dobbin when I got him, because I would have never named him that. But I got him when I was 6, and I had him well into my 20s, so I had him for a long, long time. I had no idea that horses had hip bones or ribs until I got a bigger horse, because I don't think I ever felt a rib bone or a hip bone on him ever. And I rode him bareback wherever I went. He probably had a saddle on him maybe 10 times in his life. His favorite thing to do is we would be cruising along across the yard, and he would must have seen a good clump of grass. And he would stop, put his head down, and grab a chunk of grass, and I would go sliding right down his neck. I couldn't get on him when I first had him. I'd have to take him to the ditch and put him lower and me a little bit higher so I could get on him. And I'm pretty sure he didn't do anything that I wanted him to do. I'm pretty sure that we just did whatever he wanted, and that was probably to eat a lot of grass. I could never catch him. If I didn't have anything in my hand, I could always catch him. But as soon as I went out into the pasture with a piece of rope or a bridle, he was gone to the other end, and I would chase him in circles and circles and circles, and then I would go in the house crying because I just wanted to sell him. One time I did actually say that I wanted to sell him, and somebody came and looked at him. And oh yeah, I was in college there. That's me actually. They came and looked at him, and then I went in the house crying because I couldn't sell him. So I had to hang on to him. But if he ever got out, which was frequent, when the electric fence was off, he knew it. He could hear it or sense it or something, and he would put his head down, go under the electric fence, and we had a silo room in the barn that had a pile of feed in the corner for the cows, like oats and really, really good feed, and that's where he would go. He would bury his head in the feed, and he would eat so fast until somebody came to get him. And so I could always find him. If he ever got out, I always knew exactly where he was. If I fell off, he would go right to the feed room. So he was always easy to find. But I think that God gave us, animals have a purpose on this earth, but I think that God gave us animals to enjoy because he was literally my best friend when I was growing up. And if you don't have a horse, and I'm speaking mostly to the Hanson girls, I feel strongly that every girl who wants a horse should have a horse. So I will work on your dad. I have before, but I'll keep working on him. So just have an enjoyable day and enjoy the animals that God gave us. Thank you.
Thank you, Julie. When I was a little boy, I wanted a horse real bad because my cousins who lived less than a mile away had a couple of horses and I was jealous, but I never got a horse and I'm still able to enjoy life even though I never had a horse. So I've gotten over that horse thing. So I think horses are overrated, Hanson girls. I mean, life can be good without horses, really.
You would have had hair if you had a horse.
Is that right? Gee. You can't have everything. I'm already pretty spoiled, Robbie, you know? But thanks. It's time for morning prayer. Our kind, loving Father in heaven, this is our last Sabbath of this year. We're so thankful that you're still our God. Lord, we pray for Chloe. We pray that the Holy Spirit will continue to keep working on her and her family as we move into the new year, 2020. We're so glad that Robbie was kept safe, that he wasn't injured badly yesterday. We're so thankful for the Hagen family. We love them so much. We're so blessed to have them. Lord, we pray for all of those unspoken requests that we don't know about, but you know about them, Lord. And you know the best thing to do regarding each one of them. We thank you for all of our blessings, and we have a lot of them. We pray for safe travel on the bad roads over these next few days and for the rest of the winter. Please keep people safe. We're so thankful for our animals, for our pets. We thank you, Lord, so much for our families. And Lord, we thank you for all of the opportunities that you will afford us in 2020. We thank you for all the blessings that you will send our way in 2020. We thank you that you are our best blessing this year and next year and all the years to come. We love you so much and we thank you so much for your love. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen. This time the scripture reading. We're switching it up. We're going to have our scripture reading at this time.
Okay. Our scripture reading is found in John 3:16, and I think we all know this, so instead of opening up our Bibles, why don't we just recite it together? Okay? John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen.
I guess now it's me. And you saw the Hagen Sun has special music there. Don't worry, it's coming. Okay? My iPad has been sent to the back for a double duty. So fortunately, sermons can be transferred electronically fairly easily. And I'm going to have my wife join me up here as we begin. She has a brief part with me as well. You have a bigger screen.
Yes, I do.
That's nice. Yes. We've been talking about order and chaos in the last month or two, talking about God's creation. You know the meaning of the word, what the meaning of Eden is? When God created the Garden of Eden, what does Eden mean? Oh, we need to learn this one. Eden was perfect, but that's not what it means. Beautiful. Pleasure. Garden of Eden, the garden of pleasure. Adam turns this way, he sees a fruit, he picks it up. Oh, that was good. And he gets to name the animals. That was fun. He had a lot of pleasure doing that. And he explored the rivers. And there were rocks sparkling and diamonds and gold. And his eyes were just enchanted with the beauty all around him. Even the serpent was enticing to come and look at the beautiful scales on that snake. On more than one snake, probably. But there was a lot of beauty there. And everything was perfect. And at the end of each day, God would come and say, "So what did you enjoy today? Tell me about your day." And that was the sweetest moment of their day, to share with God what it was that they experienced. Until that day when God came looking, and he couldn't find them. But he knew where they were. They ate that fruit, and the pleasure of that garden disappeared like smoke in the wind. And from that moment on, God is telling them, "I'm going to make it right. I'm going to send the seed." And so Adam and Eve, they're looking for the seed. First son is born. This is the one. And it wasn't the one. The next one. This is the one. This, no. This one sinned as well. And it can't be this one. God said he would send one. It would be perfect. It got worse and worse and worse. Finally, it comes to the point where God looks and everybody is evil continually. There's nobody good. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. God floods the earth, destroys all life, and in Noah, the promise is perpetuated. Men continue to get evil. And finally, it comes to Abraham in chapter 12 of Genesis, and it says, "Through you, I'm going to bless the whole world. In you, everyone is blessed." Today, what we're going to do is read through the story told of the promise fulfilled. We might have done it last week, but we're going to do it just a little bit different this week. We're looking at the book of Luke, chapter 1. So if you have your Bibles, I invite you to open to Luke chapter 1. It says in the verse 26, "In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, 'Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you.' But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel,
"How will this be, since I am a virgin?"
And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said,
"Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word."
And the angel departed from her. In those days, Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country to a town in Judah. And she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and she exclaimed with a loud cry,
"Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord."
And Mary said,
"My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his offspring forever."
This time, Shannon's going to share with us a song, "Breath of Heaven." How many ladies do we have here under the age of 20? Can I see your hands? You're under 20. We got a few of you here. Mary was under 20 when the angel came to her. Probably a little older than you that have raised your hands, but not by much. Did you catch what she said to the angel? Let it be. What you say to me, let it be. I'm the servant. This was not something that all of a sudden happened to her, that she was willing to serve. This was a pattern in her life. God knew that she would be willing to serve. In the same part of the story in the Bible, you have another person who receives a visit from an angel. Do you know who it was? Joseph got one, yeah. But her husband. Zechariah. Zechariah got visited by an angel as well. Zechariah was, let's say, old. He was old. His wife was old. She was at the point where she couldn't have children anymore. Because there comes a time in a woman's life when things don't work like they used to. You know, when you're a child, you can't have a child. And then when you're a woman, you can have a child. And then there comes a time when you can't. And she was at that can't. And so when the angel said, Zechariah, you're going to have a son, he says, but my wife, she can't. You're not going to do this to us. It can't happen. He says, yeah, well, it will happen, and you're going to be quiet about it until it does. He got punished because he was not willing to accept. Mary says, I'm here, I'm your servant. And then we pick up the story, Luke chapter 2. Time has gone by since the angel talked to her, about 9 months. I don't know, did she walk or did she ride on that donkey? I remember the my Bible friends. How many of you have had my Bible friends? Clip-clop, clip-clop. I still remember that story. In those days, Luke chapter 2, verse 1, in those days a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David, to be registered with Mary his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. A lot of noise with this. What do you think? They get into town, nobody notices this couple, this carpenter and his wife. He's big, ready to give birth, goes to the hotel, the inn, says, do you have any space? We don't. Oh, I'm so sorry. We don't have room. You gotta keep moving. Find yourself a place. Please hurry. It looks like she's about ready to give birth. You don't have any room. Are you sure? No, don't. Move. Finally, find a room in an inn, away from the bustle, with the animals around, just quietly looking on. If you look outside, you can see the snow falling. Can you hear it? It's quiet. That's how it was, like the winter snow. Grant, would you sing for us? Do you need me to hold that mic for you? All right.
Not like a storm, not a conquering king, no big fanfare, just quiet. Right on time, though. God promised, the very first promise was a seed. You ever seen a seed grow? Put the seed there on the piece of ground and just watch it till the first leaf comes out. We don't have the patience for that, do we? We'll come back tomorrow, take a look at it, see how far it's come, but to watch it burst out of that little shell, that's too slow. But God has His time. He's not too slow. He's not too fast. It was quiet. And the whole universe is watching this go on. And you can just sense they are bursting. Why is nobody paying attention? Somebody's got to say something. And we pick up the story in Luke chapter 2, verse 8. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. What are they talking about? Man, it's cold out here. I like the smell of the fire. Look at those stars. You remember what God said about Abraham? That his children would be innumerable as the stars. Have you ever tried counting them? And the conversation for these shepherds goes on. They're wanting something better. They're looking forward to the Messiah. Little knowing that it's tonight. And in heaven there's an angel. Can I tell him, please, can I be the one? Let me. Verse 9, and an angel of the Lord appeared to them. That's the one that was selected. And the glory of the Lord shone around them. One angel. Not his own glory, God's glory. What he's absorbed, now it's just oozing out. He can't hold it in. The glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. There's the promise. Genesis chapter 12, in you all the earth will be blessed. Great joy that will be for all the people. Jesus is, or God is tying up the promise to Abraham, to this baby. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. And at the end of the 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. Not a king rushing in. Some people would have been scared of a king. A conquering king? Bursting out of heaven? Opening up the skies? Here I am, accept me, I'm the seed. No, a baby. Nothing to fear from a baby. Shannon told me a story about one of her students. She teaches English online to Chinese students. And one of the teachers found out that, or asked the child, what are you afraid of? And the child says, I'm afraid of pineapples. Pineapples? Are you scared of a pineapple? Pineapple? I'm teaching you English. Pineapple? You don't know what a pineapple is, right? Are you scared of a pineapple? So she gets, no, here's a, she had a picture of a pineapple. She says, this is a pineapple. And the kid got up screaming and left. Kid was scared of a pineapple. Shouldn't be afraid of a pineapple. Or a flower, or a rose. God sent us a sweet fragrance when he sent his son, a rose of Bethlehem. I'd like you to listen to this song by Zachary. I don't think I could imagine that. That my son be born to wear a crown of thorns, to take my place. And yet that's what Jesus did for me and for you. And of course, people flocked from everywhere, right? Now I was quiet, unassuming. A promise that God had made years and years before. Prophecy fulfilled. A star that doesn't move in the sky. Just stays in one place. While every star wanders by. And the people of Israel so busy that they could care less. Doesn't your heart break? The promise that God has made and nobody is paying attention. Moving to Matthew chapter 2. Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he who is born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. How long before had that star appeared? It was 2 years. As we read on in the story, when Herod comes to destroy the children, how old were the children that he destroyed? 2 years and younger. So we have to do a little bit of sleuthing. The Bible doesn't spoon feed us everything. It requires us to dig into it. So 2 years have gone by. I don't think they saw the star and started traveling immediately. Because here it is, this object in the sky, it shows up. They're studying the stars, and the star is right there, hanging in place. And here goes the North Star, right past it. And the next night, it does it again. And it's just hanging in place. And they're looking and says, there's something different about that star. They went in and they studied prophecy. Because they come looking for the king. They're not searching for something random. And they come all the way to Jerusalem. Why to Jerusalem? Jesus wasn't in Jerusalem, was he? So why do they come to Jerusalem? They're searching for a king, for one. And God brought them there because he needs to wake up his people. Get up! I have fulfilled my promise. It's a 2-year-old child right now. But wake up, pay attention. And they all get up and they follow the wise men, right? They stayed put. Said, you go and find them. Let's read the rest of the story here. Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him. That's King Herod. After listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. And they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy, and going into the house, okay, into the house, not into the manger scene. I don't have any problem with you seeing the wise men showing up at the manger scene today, okay? I don't recommend anybody going out and changing little manger scenes. Say, you got this all wrong. We need to put the wise men over here. No, just leave it alone. They're thinking about it. That's an opportunity. So they went into the house where the child was. They saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. What did they give? Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. What do you do with gold? You buy things. Reality is, I don't do much with gold because I don't have any. That's my truth, okay? I do have some money, yeah. But gold is used to purchase things. It's valuable. It's only important as you're able to exchange for something else. Frankincense? I have frankincense at home. Blessed with frankincense. And it smells good. And what do you do with myrrh? What's that? It's a healant. Embalming. It was used primarily for embalming, I think, in those days. Here's a 2-year-old child and you're giving embalming substance. Here, have some embalming stuff. But these are wise men. They understand that this child isn't going to stay a child. This child will grow up. This child is a savior and will die. And they supply for this child's needs. Gold, he's going to Egypt. He's going to be in exile. They didn't know. God knew. He's going to need all of these things. They gave out of their wealth everything that they could. They praised God. And I'm looking forward to the day when I see them in heaven, these wise men. Why'd you bring frankincense? Why'd you bring myrrh? Was that sermon I preached really accurate? We can ask them questions, but we have to be there to do so. They gave valuable things. The question today is, what do we give him? What can you give to God? Does he need your gold? How about your house? Does God need your house? What about your child? Does God need your child? The reality is, it's not even your child. I was part of in the life process, but once they're that spark of life, that's God-given. I can't even give that. So everything that I have, everything that I am, I owe to God to begin with. But who I am, according to Scripture, all that I have to offer, all my good deeds, all the things that you look at me and say, wow, what a good pastor. In reality, is filthy rags. I'm broken. I'm not worthy even to be up here in front of you telling you about this. But he is worthy. I'm up here because Jesus was born as a baby and gave his life so that we could share the good news with others. There is life. Life through Jesus. God gave his very, very best. And when Jesus was born as a baby, it wasn't, here I have 10, I'm going to give you a tenth. That's not God giving us a tenth. When Jesus was born as a baby, God says, you have everything of mine. I can't give you. I couldn't give you anymore because you have everything. What are you going to do with him? What are you going to do with Jesus? My prayer is that we will return everything that we are so he can transform us into who God meant us to be in Christ. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of your Son. Thank you for pouring out the wealth of heaven, not in some tremendous outpouring of an army or a king, but in a baby. Not to scare us, but to woo us, to say, I love you, and I'm giving you all. Today, Father, as we look at Jesus, help us to respond to that love, to surrender all to you, to follow you wherever you may lead. Thank you, Father, for the fact that he was born in Bethlehem. What an interesting name for a town, because it means the house of bread. And he is the bread of life. As we partake of our food this morning, I pray, Father, that we will be reminded that Jesus is the bread of life, come to give us life eternal. We ask these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen.